your assertive voice.
That's the only voice I have. At least she's honest. It's the assertive voice.
And that's why Bobby said he's so scared.
I appreciate it.
Stay there. No, go, just go to head on out. There you go.
All right, we'll go ahead and get started. We'll let them finish up their class and then they can join us. So, I want to say Happy Mother's Day this morning. We're going to start by singing page 249, Jesus Paid It All. We're going to do the first, second, and last verse, if you will all stand. And if you fill it up, get another one. If you don't have one, we'll just take one of Rena's.
You can put them in a Ziploc bag if you have some more change that you want to
send.
Youth
rally for the, this is the Association Youth Rally, which kicks off next Wednesday night, or next Sunday night, the 15th, if I remember right. At 6 p.m., it's going to be at Bluntsville Baptist Church. We will be taking a band. So any of y'all that's parents of the youth that want to come, you're more than welcome to come if you want to help try to keep them in line. But we will be attending this. In the way of birthdays, we was going to sing happy birthday to Crystal, but I don't see her here. And praise report, Miss Donna's back. See, I told you I was going to get up here. So you the youth bonfire, we rescheduled it. It's going to be announced Right now, we're probably thinking in 2 to 3 weeks we'll be having a youth bonfire that the whole church is invited to. So I'll be cooking Miss Donna something really special at the bonfire. Yeah. Is any anniversaries? Y'all have already got me y'all on, so we don't have to do it.
What about it, Max?
I thought we did. I don't remember us getting
you. You got us Wednesday night, didn't you?
I think we need to sing it again, don't y'all?
There's other people
sing. All right, let's sing Happy Anniversary, right?
Happy Anniversary to you. Happy Anniversary to you. Happy Anniversary, God bless you. Happy Anniversary to you.
How many years?
9 years.
I covet your prayers.
Is there any other announcements? Okay. Prayer requests? See, I'm used to just sitting back and letting Davis do this. In a way of prayer requests, we've got Bob Davis and his family, of course. Is there any others? Yes, ma'am.
Remember Mr. Bob Cosette? He's having some pacemaker put in Thursday.
Remember Easy? Easy sweating. Speaking of a birthday girl. Any others?
Wesley's was the fourth, too.
The fourth?
Yeah.
When we get done with prayer, we'll get y'all, okay?
Remember
the
Chris and Lindsay both, yeah. I want to especially remember Malia. Of course, you know, we've had this week with my mom, but you know, her mom passed away in November. And so, this being Mother's Day, every year for as long as I can remember, you know, she's had the family over. And of course, she's not here this morning. It's just hard. But Malia's having a pretty rough day.
I seen a picture of my mom on Facebook yesterday for Mother's Day when we took her out to eat and to get her hair cut, and it was just sad. So, pray for the lost mother that's in heaven today and the family that's not having with them today.
Yes, sir. The holidays are hard.
Can be, can't they?
But we lean on the Lord. That's what we lean most on. Anyone else?
Heavenly Father God, again, we're so grateful to be a part of God, just the worship service here this morning on such a special day. God, we don't ever want to take for granted the opportunity to be in your house, Lord, but we especially don't want to take for granted the opportunity of attending, Lord, with our mothers, Lord, those who gave us life, God, those who have raised us, who have taught us our manners, who have made us very much the people that we are today, God. We're so grateful for their influence, selfless love, God, that you impart to them, Lord. God, we just don't ever miss opportunities to tell them that we love them. We want to make sure that we invest in them every bit as much as they have invested in us, God. And again, we're just so grateful for the gift of mothers that you have given the world. God, we ask you to be with us during the worship session this morning. God, I ask you to be with us. Help us to be honest. Help us to be open, Lord, to worship you freely, God, and in truth. Lord, we ask you to please be with the prayer requests, Lord, that have been mentioned. God, the medical needs that exist out there. Those who are mourning today, Lord, the loss of loved ones, of their mothers, of people that, you know, that are important in their life. God, just the pain that can be special and deep on a day like today. God, just please give them the peace that surpasses all understanding. God, we thank you for your love, grace, and mercy. We ask you to please help us to be more like you and less like ourselves every day.
Page 223, Nothing But the Blood. They sing the first, second, and fourth.
Lord, thank you for all the mothers and everyone who attends today and just if I'd have known the selection of music, because it never fails. I kind of get emotional sometimes. I thought, oh, I should have went before that song. So, but I said a little prayer because my lesson, and it is very strange to me, is the years I've done this, it blesses my heart because if it's a burden on me.
Amen.
It's like, it's got to be done. And there's a lesson that has to be taught. Let's just do it simple. Okay. Molding the future. Let your hand become my help, for I have chosen your purpose. From Psalms 119:173. What can be more challenging than raising children? The Lord helps make a world of difference as we struggle daily to do the right things. Susanna was a remarkable mother who lived at many years ago. Times were tough for her. She had 19 children. This starts getting like, whoa, you know. That's why I know I can get through this. I ain't got 19. But only 9 lived through infancy. I know there's a lot that happened with. She taught them basic education, including Greek and Latin. She made music come alive. Her children learned to read poetry and music, play musical instruments, and write and compose their own music. I know today that when we look around, we think just getting them through school, getting them to finish school is one thing. But knowing if you got to write and compose the music, she was astonishing. Some people said she was too strict. Yet her immersed love helped temper the times when she had to be firm and disciplined. With discipline, she taught her children the value of natural consequences and made them work hard to solve their problems. And although she was busy with family, the household and responsibilities, she spent 15 minutes a day with each child and faithfully held each one up in prayer. Susanna retained love and respect from her family, and she expected the best from them, even into adulthood. She encouraged them to make serving God the center of their lives. Their very purpose for being. I wonder if Susanna Wesley knew that God was helping her mold the lives of her sons, John, Charles, and her grandson Samuel S. Wesley, and 2 great Christian leaders. The wisdom and love she gave multiplied through her offspring. Outstanding sermons, poetry, and hymns that will inspire even today. Suzanne Wesley may inspire us to set new goals, but we don't need to measure up to her. We can simply be ourselves and know that God graciously understands and helps. He knows our strengths and weaknesses and stays close to us, helping every day. It goes into more of Suzanne, and I like this. This devotion hit me, and it pulled across to the point. God's grace for moms. My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. Psalms 121:2. It would be easy to think of Susanna Wesley as someone who must have been constantly inspired and driven by God, a mother who held all the wisdom from the Bible in her mind, heart, and soul. More than likely, however, she suffered the same insecurities and struggles as all of us. I wonder how many times she pondered out her feelings and concerns and burdens to her Heavenly Father in the same way that we do today. It is a comfort to me that Susanna wasn't perfect when she was at her best. God was there for her, graciously, patiently correcting her errors and helping her to make things right. There's something more valuable than being the perfect mother. It is constantly asking our merciful Lord to create and receive a pure heart within us so that we can pass a sincere, unselfish love onto our priceless kids. When we fall short, His grace helping bridge our gaps. Praise be to Him for doing so. Thank you for my children, Lord, that they are most precious gifts from you. I look at them and see how they are reflect different family members with their hair, eyes, dimples, and smiles. I pray that they will have your eyes and learn the miraculous wonders of your ways. Help me teach my children the lesson in the word. Remind me to talk about your scripture in our home. Make this become a way of life for them. Throughout their days, I pray that my children and grandchildren will apply your lessons to and decisions they make. Thank you, Lord, for your grace and forgiveness. Thank you for your love and your guidance. Use our family, I pray, to bring honor to you. And if you go to my house, you can find about 50,000 devotions because I enjoy because it gives me scripture and then it gives me a lesson. And it kind of bridges the gap to understanding His words better. But as I was looking through one, it says He offers hope. He is the great healer. He is always there with you. He gives you strength to persevere. He comforts you. He gives you courage. He loves you. He gives you you power to accomplish miraculous things. He shows you the importance of prayer. His attitude shows you how to live. And He gave His life on the cross just for us. Not just the mothers or women, but all of us. And my thing lately has been because moms always fix things, and I'm always, I've got to fix this. I've got to fix this. I've got to do this. I can't say no. I've got to do this. And it was getting to me, and I thought, what do I need to do? And a friend of mine said, be still. And I thought, be still? How can you be still? I feel like, in a lot of ways, I have ADHD. So my thing is, I've got to keep this stuff going. I got to keep doing all this stuff. But as I read more about being still, I didn't realize it was talked about so much in the Bible when I started studying it. 7 perfect reminders to be still. Be still and know that I am God. Psalms 46:10. The Lord will fight for you while you keep still. Exodus 14:14. Now then, stand still and see the great things that Lord is about to do before your eyes. 1 Samuel 12:16. Don't be afraid, just stand still and watch the Lord rescue you today. Exodus 14:13. Be still in the presence of the Lord and patiently wait for Him to act. Psalms 37:7. They that will wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Isaiah 40:31. You will keep perfectly peaceful the one whose mind remains focused on you. Isaiah 26:3. And these are all reminders for the women in their Mother's Day card. Because the be still sometimes is hard to do, as mothers know. Because we like to fix something. Even if it's little things, we'll do it for them. We have to stop. I mean, we want to still. We can. The good thing about it is I've realized, pray and live it with the Lord. And then sometimes that's like, whew, that's a lot easier. I wish I'd done that sooner. Because I was studying and thinking. I look at it now and think I was a mediocre mom. But I was good to compare it when a lot of people look at it. But now, when you start having grandchildren around, you're like, oh my goodness, there's more people in my little triangle that I've got to put on my prayer list, that I've got to worry about daily, and it gets to you. So I've had an eye-opening experience with the Lord, so. Okay, we have cards, and if Savannah, Remy, y'all want to come pass out?
You're just going to pass out.
You're going to pass this out. Man, this ain't what they were doing. This ain't what they do Wednesday night. No, no, I can guarantee you. Kinley, do you want to help pass out? Yes, and Savannah, come here. We need roses passed out. Come on. Oh, yeah. Okay. And you can come back and get some more. I've got some things for Miss Melinda.
Oh, thank you so much.
Yes. Okay, and these are little prayer boxes. When your head starts to worry and your mind just can't rest, put your prayers down on paper and let God do the rest. There are some little pieces of paper in here, then you can go from there. Will you have passed these out too? Here's you some more. Oh, they didn't? Did Sandy get one? Oh.
She's got two more. She's got two. I'll do it.
Okay, the next thing, our little hands on Wednesday nights help make. There's a tea light candle in here, and they are homemade candle holders. So y'all can enjoy those. And then there's a fingernail file in there with a reminder. Oh, and there's each one of them are different. Obviously, you will take these your finger file out before lighting your candle, making sure these mommies understand. Be kind to every kind. But they painted these on Wednesday night. Miss Mary, do you have one? Okay. Your mom's got one. Has every mother got a box, a card, a rose, and a candle holder with five.
Or anything you would like to say before I turn the service over to Brother Max. A little tip, don't let her pick your job, or else she'll get covered in rocks on the playground.
If you don't volunteer, you'll get volunteered.
What's the date?
Everybody keeps asking that and I mess it up. It's the third week of July. Okay. So it's the week of the 18th and 19th of the
mm-hmm. Brother Max, if you're ready.
Like I said, good morning. It's been a good service so far. I had had a thought, you know, for a couple of weeks, and I had been pondering around about this thing, but I guess, in a way, to some unforeseen circumstances, I'm here this morning, but I'm going to do the will of God. But the thought I had had, it started out nasty, but it goes back. We're going to flip back a little bit. It starts in Matthew, and I've had those three words on my mind for probably a month now. John chapter 18. And I'm going to start, it's in the 18th verse, and I'm going to start with the second verse in the 18th verse. And Judas also, which betrayed him, knew the place, for Jesus oftentimes retorted thither with his disciples. Judas then, having received the band of men and officers from the chief priests and Pharisees, coming thither with lanterns and torches and weapons. And Jesus, therefore, knowing all things that should come upon him, went forth and said unto them, whom seek ye? They answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus said unto them, I am he. And Jesus also, which betrayed him, stood with them. And as soon then as he had said unto them, I am he, they went backward and fell to the ground. Then asked he them again, whom seek ye? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus answered, I have told you that I am he. If therefore you seek me, let these go their way. As I started this, I thought about whom seek you for, I don't know, for a month now. And I kept thinking about, you know, the thought was, why do we come to church? What are we looking for? You know, that was my thought, was whom seek you? Just put it in plain, what are you looking for? Why are you here? Why are we doing the things we do? Why do we come to church? And as I thought about whom seek you and what are we looking for, I got to thinking about over in Genesis where Joseph was foretelling the dreams of what was coming. And I believe, if I'm not mistaken, I can get my glasses on here where I can see. That goes with the 37th chapter of Genesis about Joseph. You know, I might not read none, I might just paraphrase a lot of this, but if you want to go to the 37th chapter and start there. But Joseph was well beloved of his father. He could interpret dreams. And he was, I guess, from what, if you read the Bible, it says he was the most loved of his father. And I'm assuming that's because he was a young Israelite. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children because he was a son of his old age and he made him a coat of many colors. Now if you go on down through there, and I'm going to skip around, it said, and Joseph dreamed a dream and he told it to his brethren and they hated him yet more. You know, as I thought about these dreams and I thought about what whom seek ye, if you'll look over in there, why did they hate the Lord? Why did they hate Jesus? Because of the truth. Why did they hate Joseph? Why did his brothers hate him? It was because of the truth. They didn't want to hear the truth. And that dream that he told them, he said, for lack of a better word, y'all gonna worship me one of these days. Y'all gonna have to worship me. And they didn't want to hear that, because here this was little old Joseph, the kid of the bunch, that was gonna have to come for lack of a better word. Some of you, if you read on through there, they were gonna have to dig. They, we need something from them. They didn't want to hear the truth. And I thought about that as we come to church, and I thought, I'll go back to John over there about whom seek ye. Like I asked, you know, what are you looking for? Why do we come to church? What are we looking for in church? Are we looking for the truth? Are we looking just to come socialize with our friends? Are we looking to come just to be seen? Are we really looking for the truth? Are we looking for Jesus?
Amen.
Yes,
that's the big thing we need to be coming to church, but we need to be looking for Jesus. Joseph there, if you think about it, Joseph represented, to me, he represented the truth.
Amen.
And his brothers, they tried everything in the world to get rid of the truth. What do we do a lot of times? We try to hide the truth. We want to keep it. People want to keep it so deep down they don't want to hear the truth, because a lot of times it steps on their toes and it hurts their feelings. Maybe we need our feelings hurt a little bit more. Maybe we need our toes stepped on a little bit more to understand and do Jesus' work his will. I heard a preacher several years ago, and I'm going to say this, he preached on this, and it took him about, it was in a revival, and it took him about three nights, or it took him the whole week to preach it on this one. Joseph, it was called From the Pit to the Prison to the Palace. Joseph started out in the pit, he ended up in the palace, he ended up in prison, and he ended up, boy, was over with his in the palace. And that's what it was. They was having to come beg him because he was over. Even the Pharaoh knew who Joseph was. And if you read in there, he talks about your God. You know, that's what your God says, because he interpreted dreams for the Pharaoh. Tell him, said, hey, you know, this is what's coming to pass. We've got preachers, we've got people all over the world today telling us what's coming to pass, and yet we want to sit around with our fingers stuck in our ear and not hear. We want to hide from the truth. To me, putting Joseph in that pit, they were trying to hide the truth. Pharaoh, the guy and I, keep, let me get right over here to this. Y'all have to keep giving me. Now, I'm gonna read this in the 37th chapter. Come now, therefore, let us slay him. No, that's not where I want. Now, you're going to bear with me. I am looking, as Joseph tested back in chapter 39. You know, Potiphar was a big guy, and Joseph got to where he could go and come as he pleased. He went and done what he wanted to. And Potiphar's wife, I guess for lack of a better word, caught eyes for Joseph. She wanted Joseph. But Joseph, being the man he was, being the truth, he didn't want nothing to do with her and told her, I don't want nothing to do with you. But she lied and got him in trouble. There you go. We'll try to cover up the truth with lies. Sooner or later, it's going to come out. If you'll read on into this, and we get further on into this, if you get further into it, read it. Take it home and read it sometime. That's a good story. That is a good read right there in Genesis about Joseph. If you'll read on into that, later on, when the Pharaoh had the dreams, they ended up getting Joseph to come out of prison to interpret his dreams. And old Potiphar there, can you imagine being Potiphar and telling his wife, saying, hey, that guy that you had put in prison is my boss now. He's over me. So you can't hide the truth. Sooner or later, it's going to come out. Same thing with over here. If you go back to Matthew, to John, when Jesus was born, if you look, they tried to kill Jesus to start with. You're not going to kill the truth.
Amen.
They thought they killed him when he got a little older, but guess what? He came on back. He rose again.
Amen.
Joseph rose up out of this pit. Joseph rose up out of prison. Joseph told them, a lot of people, what they didn't want to hear.
Amen.
And that's what's going on today. People are telling people what they don't want to hear. A good preacher, let me put it that way, a good preacher will tell you what you don't want to hear. And people get mad about it. And they want to do away with it.
Amen.
They don't want to hear it. They try to suppress it. That's the problem. We're trying to suppress too much today. We need to be understanding and have our own ears of what God wants to hear, wants us to hear. We need to be attentive.
Amen.
We need to be sure of what we're looking for.
Amen.
Whom seek you? What are you looking for? Why are you here? Why do we do the things we do? But in closing, I'd just like to say, what are you looking for? Brother Bobby, I'll lift you up. Y'all got a song? I know that was short, but that was my thought. If you're looking for the truth, you can find it today.
Same page 429. You all stand.
Be with those, dear Heavenly Father, who during this time their hearts are heavy. God, we ask that you just give them a comfort and a peace, dear Heavenly Father, that only you can bring. We thank you again for every blessing. We ask you, God, to watch over us, keep us safe. And when you're done with us here upon this earth, may we ever be found in your will and in your presence. For we ask it all in the blessed name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.